تعال هنا.
ينبي يرضيك هم.
بسم الله الرحمن الرحيم، الحمد لله والصلاة والسلام على رسول الله، أما بعد، أخذنا في الدرس الماضي ما يتعلق بشروط الحضور في الدورة وبالأسئلة التي لا بد منها قبل البدء في الدراسة.
In the name of Allah, the most merciful, the bestower of mercy, indeed all praise is due to Allah, and may the peace and blessings of Allah be upon His Messenger. We took in the previous lesson the conditions that we all agreed upon for studying, and also some of the questions that we will ask or we ask before we begin studying the actual text.
لماذا ندرس النواقض؟
So why do we study the maxims invalidate?
ما هي النواقض؟
What are or what's the meaning of النواقض؟
هل هي محصورة بعشر نواقض؟
Are they limited to a particular number or 10؟
هل ذكر العدد في نصوص الكتاب والسنة له مفهوم أو ليس له مفهوم، أي محدد أو غير محدد؟ ولماذا يذكر النبي صلى الله عليه وسلم أحيانا العدد وهو ليس له مفهوم؟
And does the fact that a number has been mentioned in the Quran, the Sunnah, does this always necessitate that there's a limit to those matters by that number? And also, if it doesn't necessitate a limit, then why does the Prophet صلى الله عليه وسلم mention a number?
وكذلك ذكرنا أن بعض العلماء رحمهم الله تعالى يقول يمكن أن تحصر النواقض في أمور أربعة. نعم.
And also we mentioned that some of the scholars, may Allah have mercy upon them, they've said that it's possible to limit or to enumerate those matters or summarize those matters which invalidate a person's Islam to four things.
نعم. الآن بإذن الله تعالى نبدأ بقراءة النواقض، وعلى ما اتفقنا عليه تتركوا كل شيء وتنصتوا إلى الدرس. نعم.
So now we'll begin with reading the actual text, but upon the conditions that we agreed previously, that you leave alone everything, you don't look into the text, and you listen to the reading.
نعم. بسم الله.
بالإنجليزية.
نعم.
So the author Muhammad ibn Abdul Wahhab, may Allah have mercy upon him, he mentioned at the beginning of his text, in the name of Allah, the most merciful, the bestower of mercy.
نعم. بدأ المؤلف رحمه الله تعالى ببسم الله الرحمن الرحيم.
So the author, may Allah have mercy upon him, he began with بسم الله الرحمن الرحيم, this statement, this phrase.
لماذا يبدأ العلماء رحمهم الله تعالى بالبسملة؟
Why do the scholars, may Allah the Most High have mercy upon them, why do the scholars always begin by mentioning the name of Allah?
والله أعلم أن السبب في بدء العلماء رحمه الله تعالى المؤلفات بالبسملة أمور خمسة.
Allah knows best, but the reason behind which the scholars they always begin their works by mentioning the name of Allah, there are five reasons.
اقتداء بالكتاب العزيز.
Number one, in maintain or in following the guidance of the book, i.e. the Quran.
اقتداء بالنبي صلى الله عليه وسلم في مراسلاته.
In following the guidance of the Prophet صلى الله عليه وسلم in how he used to write his letters.
اقتداء بعلماء السلف رحمهم الله تعالى.
In following the guidance of the great scholars who came previously.
تيمنا وتبركا للبداء ببسم الله، لأن كل شيء يذكر على اسم الله سبحانه وتعالى تحل فيه البركة.
And also in wanting or seeking blessing by mentioning the name of Allah, because everything which is began with the name of Allah, then in this there is some blessing.
الأمر الخامس استئناسا بحديث كل أمر ذي بال لا يبدأ فيه ببسم الله فهو أقطع. هذا الحديث يضعف بعض العلماء، وبعض العلماء يستأنس به في البدء ببسم الله الرحمن الرحيم.
And then the fifth matter is in complying with the hadith of the Prophet صلى الله عليه وسلم, where the Prophet صلى الله عليه وسلم said كل أمر ذي بال, that every matter which has some importance to it, if it is not begun with the name of Allah, then it is maqtu', meaning the blessing in it is deficient. So even though some of the scholars have mentioned that this hadith is weak, it has some weakness in it, some others, they use this حديث as a supporting evidence.
نعم. فإن كان حديث ضعيف أكفي الأمور التي ذكرناها قبل هذا.
So if we say that the hadith is weak, is ضعيف, then it's enough that we've mentioned the four other things.
ثم أن المؤلف رحمه الله تعالى ذكر هذه النواقض العشرة بقوله نعم.
And then after this, the author, may Allah have mercy upon him, he mentioned the 10 matters which invalidate a person's text by saying,
نعم.
Know that the matters which invalidate a person's Islam are 10.
نعم. وقلنا هذا من المؤلف رحمه الله تعالى فيه اتباع لهدي النبي صلى الله عليه وسلم.
And we mentioned that in this, the author, may Allah have mercy upon him, he's following the guidance of the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam.
أراد منا أن نحفظ 10 نواقض.
So he wanted from us that we should memorize 10 matters which invalidate a person's Islam.
وإلا فالنواقض أكثر من هذه العشر.
Otherwise, the matters which invalidate a person's Islam are more than 10.
ثم بدأ المؤلف رحمه الله تعالى بالناقض الأول.
And then the author, may Allah have mercy upon him, he began by mentioning the first matter which invalidates.
نعم فقال.
And so he said, first, الشرك. الشرك in the worship of Allah, the Most High. Allah the Most High said, indeed Allah does not forgive that partners are ascribed to him. However, he forgives anything other than that for whomsoever he wills. And the Most High said, verily, whoever sets up partners with Allah in worship, then Allah has made upon him, then Allah has made paradise forbidden upon him, and he has made the fire his abode. There will be no helpers for the oppressors. There's a mistake in the text.
نعم. الناقض الأول.
So therefore, the first matter which invalidates a person's Islam is
الشرك في عبادة الله.
Is a shirk, i.e. ascribing partners in the worship of Allah.
الشرك نسأل الله سبحانه وتعالى السلام والعافية ينقسم إلى قسمين.
الشرك, and we ask Allah's safety and pardoning, it can be divided into two categories.
شرك أكبر,
a major form of shirk, شرك أكبر,
وشرك أصغر,
and شرك أصغر, a minor form of shirk.
الشرك ينقسم والله أعلم إلى قسمين, أكبر وأصغر.
So once again, الشرك, it can be divided into two categories. شرك أكبر, which is major shirk, and شرك أصغر, which is minor shirk.
قصد المؤلف رحمه الله تعالى بالناقض الأول بالشرك هنا أي الشرك الأكبر, لأن الشرك الأكبر مخرج من الملة.
So the author, may Allah have mercy upon him, when he mentioned a shirk here as being the first matter which invalidates a person's Islam, he intended by this a shirk al-akbar, the major form of shirk. Because shirk al-akbar, major shirk, this is the type of shirk which invalidates a person's Islam or exits a person out of the fold of Islam.
كما أن التوحيد ينقسم إلى ثلاثة أقسام, توحيد الربوبية وتوحيد الألوهية وتوحيد الأسماء والصفات, كذلك الشرك يكون في الألوهية وفي الربوبية وفي الأسماء والصفات. نعم.
So just as we say that التوحيد, it has three categories. توحيد الربوبية and توحيد الألوهية and توحيد الأسماء والصفات. نشرح بعدين. الربوبية والألوهية.
نعم.
We can also say that a shirk, it can also occur in these three categories, i.e. shirk in الربوبية and shirk in uluhiyya and shirk in al-asma wa sifat. And the Shaykh is going to explain the meaning of rububiyya, uluhiyya and asma wa sifat, these three categories.
Tawheed al-rububiyya huwa ifrad Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala bi af'alih aw ifrad Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala bil khalq wal mulk wal tadbir.
So the meaning of tawheed al-rububiyya is singling out Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala in his actions, meaning that you single out Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, that he's the one who is the khaliq, the one who creates, he's the one who is the malik, the one who owns or possesses. He's the one who is the Raziq, the one who provides. He's the one who is Mudabbir, the one who controls all the affairs.
نعم. هذا التوحيد أي توحيد الربوبية أقر به الكفار الذين بعث فيهم النبي عليه الصلاة والسلام, لكن لم يدخلهم هذا في الإسلام لأنهم لم يقروا بتوحيد الألوهية. نعم.
So this type of توحيد, even the disbelievers at the time of the Prophet صلى الله عليه وسلم, they accepted and they believed in this type of توحيد. However, their belief and their acceptance of this type of tawheed, it didn't enter them into al-Islam.
نعم. التوحيد الثاني النوع الثاني من أنواع التوحيد هو توحيد الألوهية أو توحيد العبودية أو توحيد العبادة.
So the second form of توحيد, the second category of توحيد is توحيد الألوهية. Or we can say توحيد العبودية, or we can say توحيد العبادة.
نعم. توحيد الألوهية هو إفراد الله سبحانه وتعالى بأفعال العباد, إفراد الله سبحانه وتعالى بالعبادة. نعم.
And the meaning of توحيد الألوهية is that you sing, that Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala is single out in the actions of the slaves, or that Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala is the singling of Allah in all acts of worship.
فمن صرف شيء قليل أو كثير من العبادة لغير الله فقد وقع في الشرك الأكبر الذي وقع فيه الكفار الذين بعث فيهم النبي صلى الله عليه وسلم. ولهذا قال المؤلف الشرك في عبادة الله. نعم.
So whomsoever directs any act of worship to other than Allah, then he has fallen into the major shirk. The major shirk, which is the same shirk, the polytheism or disbelief of the disputes at the time of the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam. For this reason, the author said that the first matter which invalidates a person Islam is shirk in the worship of Allah, i.e. in an act of worship of Allah.
على ما سيأتي معنا من أمثلة على الشرك الأكبر أنه لو ذبح لغير الله محبة وتعظيما مرة واحدة فقد وقع في الشرك الأكبر, وهذا شرك في الألوهية. نعم.
So as we're going to discuss shortly, that anybody who sacrifices an animal for other than Allah in love and ta'zim, meaning exalting the person that he's sacrificing for, then this person has fallen into a shirk al-akbar, the major form of shirk.
نعم. وسيأتي المؤلف رحمه الله تعالى بأمثلة على الشرك الأكبر, وسنضيف على هذه الأمثلة بعض الأمثلة على الشرك الأكبر وكذلك على الشرك الأصغر. نسأل الله سبحانه وتعالى السلام والعافية. نعم.
So the author, he's going to mention some examples of shirk al-akbar, major shirk, and we'll also make some additions or mention more examples to shirk akbar, major shirk and minor shirk. And we ask Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala for safety and for pardoning.
نعم. فالضابط في الشرك الأكبر أنه مخرج من الملة. نعم.
And the meaning or the factor which decides something which is shirk akbar is that shirk akbar, the major form of shirk, it exits a person out of the fold of Islam.
والأصغر غير مخرج من الملة.
And as for the minor form of shirk, shirk al-asghar, then this doesn't take a person out of the fold of Islam.
الشرك الأكبر محبط لكل الأعمال.
Shirk al-akbar, major shirk, it invalidates all of the actions.
والأصغر محبط للعمل الخاص كالصلاة إذا خلطها شيء من الرياء.
And as for shirk asghar, the minor form of shirk, then this only invalidates that action in which the shirk is found. So for example, if somebody has a riya, if somebody shows off in the prayer, then it invalidates that prayer.
صاحب الشرك الأكبر نسأل الله السلام العافية إذا مات عليه فهو مخلد خلود أبدي في النار.
And the person who has within him shirk akbar, major shirk, and we ask Allah for safety and pardoning, the person who dies upon this, then he will enter into Jahannam, into the fire, and remain therein forever.
وإذا مات نسأل الله السلام العافية على الشرك الأصغر.
And if a person dies upon shirk asghar, minor shirk,
يعذب بقدر الشرك ثم يدخل الجنة,
then he will be punished according to the level of his shirk, and then he will enter into Jannah, paradise.
الأكبر مبيح للدم والمال.
And shirk al-akbar, the major form of shirk, it makes a person's wealth and a person's blood and wealth permitted to take.
لكن هذا من السلطان.
However, this is according to the, or is under the command of the ruler.